Hello, welcome to Conversations in Calvinism. I'm Dan Chapa, and I'm joined, as always, by my very good friend, Turretinfan. How you doing, Turretinfan?
Doing great. Glad to be on.
Yeah, likewise. So this is somewhat of a follow-up episode. So our last episode was on Frankfurt examples, and it was with Colton, and we had a great discussion. And I think that discussion stands on its own in terms of analyzing Frankfurt examples. But there was one piece, I actually had put together slides, and one piece that we didn't get to, and I wanted to follow up on that point. And we talked about it a little bit, and you discussed some interest in getting into the exegesis that's relative to Frankfurt examples. So with that said, I guess if you're good with that, I can go ahead and share my screen. We can pull up the slides and go through this.
Yeah, and I should point out, we did not try to invite Colton for this, not because we don't care for his input, we value his input. It's just this one, we just felt like we were going to tackle the two of us. No disrespect intended, right? Anything like that.
Yeah, absolutely. And it was kind of, the spur of the moment and everything like that. So cool. All right. So screen shared. Let me know if you can see this.
I see it.
Okay, cool. All right. So where we left off was with the Mullenist Frankfurt example. There's one other slide on our flickers of freedom enough, but we somewhat covered some of this in the episode. So I'm going to leave this one be and just go right to the last slide, which is the one that I think would be of most interest. But let me quickly recap. So Frankfurt examples are put together by Harry Frankfurt. They're basically these thought experiments where there's this person, Jones, and Jones is maybe doing something like voting between Democrat and Republican or something like that. And then there's an intervener, Black, who's monitoring his mind or is just a good judge of character or that sort of thing. And so if the if Jones, who's going to vote, if he's a so Black, the intervener, the guy, the manipulator, if he wants the vote to for sure be Republican. So if Jones is about to vote Republican, he just lets him do it. But if he's about to vote Democrat, then he jumps in and intervenes and makes Jones vote Republican. So he's guaranteeing the outcome is going to be a Republican vote, but in the actual sequence, he doesn't have to intervene because on his own, Jones goes ahead and votes Republican. But if Jones was going to vote Democrat, then Black would intervene and make him vote Republican. So that's the idea. And the motivation behind that is to show a disconnect between responsibility and this ability to do otherwise. And it's this idea that we don't need this ability to do otherwise to account for, especially account for moral responsibility. So now the argument I'm going to make now is not aimed at Harry Frankfurt himself, but what has been done with Harry Frankfurt's work by Fisher and Ravisa, especially in terms of developing a theory called semi-compatibilism. Now, what semi-compatibilism is highly motivated by these Frankfurt examples. And it's this idea of, well, let's not go all the way on compatibilism. Let's only go half the way on compatibilism. So with classical compatibilism, the idea is that determinism is compatible both with free will and with moral responsibility. Whereas semi-compatibilism is a halfway situation, and it says that determinism is responsible with moral responsibility, and they stop there, and they're either agnostic to or skeptical of whether determinism and free will are compatible, or they just leave that out of their account altogether. But they don't commit on determinism being compatible with free will. So that therefore they're semi-compatibilist, not full compatibilist, I guess is one way to say it, or classical compatibilist. So I guess that's some framing for the issue. So before I go on into my actual objection to semi-compatibilism per se, do you have any issue with the framing itself?
I don't think so. I would tend to, I mean, that is a, you know, that's terminology that's been developed. That is, you know, those are the names that are usually associated with the position that has that label from what I've seen. And I don't claim to have seen everything or anything like that.
Okay. Very good. Very good.
The one thing I would add to that is, from my standpoint, the question of moral responsibility is the more important of the two questions between the question of free will and the question of moral responsibility. I think free will is only significant as an issue if you tie it to something else, to something bigger. In other words, if the point is moral responsibility is, if you, you know, for example, if someone would say moral responsibility is fully compatible with determinism, and the question of whether or not it's also compatible with free will at that point seems to be moot, because there's not some additional benefit that inures from free will if moral responsibility is already attached to the agent. So that's kind of one of my, you know, at the outset thoughts.
Okay, that's helpful, but I'm going to push back, and I'm hopefully it'll become clear why I'm pushing back. But I'm going to introduce what I think is another advantage to free will, other than the moral intuition, and argue for there's solid reasons to believe in free will other than just our moral intuition on responsibility or not. And the primary reason I'm going to introduce is just faithfulness to the scripture. And I think that the scripture simply teaches that we have free will. Now, I think you could arguably say, well, free will could be defined in a classical compatibilist way, or it could be defined in a libertarian way. And maybe even there's other options on the table, but I think those two usually exhaust the gambit, at least as far as I've seen, between classical compatibilism and libertarianism. But I think you got to go with one of those two. And I don't think you can go semi-compatibilism full stop. Now, if someone is a semi-compatibilist and a classical compatibilist, then it's really a confusing terminology, right? Because, like, okay, so let me just get that out of the way first. So let's say, for example, you have water, then you have dry land, and then you have quicksand, right? So the land is a solid, the water is not a solid, and then you have this quicksand, which is a semi-solid, right? Okay, so it's kind of odd to say you're on a semi-solid and a solid. It doesn't really make sense. You can't be on both at the same time, that sort of thing. So if somebody claims to be a semi-compatibilist and a classical compatibilist at the same time, they're just a classical compatibilist. Semi-compatibilism, the ideas within semi-compatibilism specifically are things like you're responsible if your reason is responsive, and if you have, basically mechanism ownership. So those core ideas are already a part of classical compatibilism. It's just classical compatibilism goes further and adds a conditional analysis of the ability to do otherwise, and a commitment to compatibilist free will, whereas semi-compatibilism leaves that stuff out. So if somebody says that they're a semi-compatibilist and a classical compatibilist, my main issue there is just on the semantic grounds of you're just a classical compatibilist. You're not a semi-compatibilist at that point. But in any case, I think you're, but that's semantic, not substantive. So I think the substantive issue is there a motivation to hold to free will apart from moral responsibility and intuitions about moral accountability? And my answer is yes, based on just the sheer exegesis of Scripture. There's statements in Scripture about free will. There's statements in Scripture about the ability to do otherwise. And just to be faithful to that, I think somebody has to at least be a classical compatibilist. So I guess with all that said, unless you have more preliminary thoughts, maybe we can get into some Scripture passages that I think teach that we have free will.
One teeny tiny question for you, I guess.
Okay.
If the person's... I don't know who out there, you know, says that they're both a compatibilist and a semi-compatibilist. I'm just not aware. So I'm not trying to speak on their behalf, whoever it is. Okay. But if what somebody means is they accept the semi-compatibilist arguments and they think, like, they favor full compatibilism, but they're not necessarily fully persuaded yet. I mean, do we have to create a new label of like semi-compatibilism where they're like, they firmly hold to the semi-compatibilist layer and they think they hold to the next layer, but they're not sure about that or something like that?
Yeah, so those folks, if they exist, they're the target market, and I'm going to try to convince them that they should just own up to classical compatibilism and, frankly, whatever baggage classical compatibilism hauls along. Here's the issue that I see happening is people think that they can... Classical compatibilism has a long history. Some think it's great, you know, like they think, you know, Edwards has solved all the problems or something like that. But there's been a lot of pushback, and essentially most people say that classical compatibilists are have problems with definitions of terms. It's the way they're defining terms. It's not... that's the primary issue. So some people say, well, we can get out of this whole game of playing around with the definition of terms and arguing the definition of terms, and let's just skip that, bypass all that, and let's go the semi-compatibilism way. No, I don't think so. I think you have to still, if you want to be faithful to Scripture, you have to mess around with what's the definition of free will, what's the definition of choosing, choice, deliberation, the ability to do otherwise, all that stuff. You have to deal with that directly. So the people that you identified is exactly who I'm disagreeing with and trying to motivate to just own up to classical compatibilism.
Do you have some specific people in mind, or you don't have to name them if you don't want to? I'm just curious. Do you have some specific people in mind? Or?
Well, I don't want to name names, but
that's okay. I don't think we have to.
I'll give one hint. About 13 years ago, I had a long and extended debate with one of these individuals. And I think semi-compatibilism was the issue why we couldn't get onto the same page. So, anyways. Okay. I will leave it at
that. I'm trying to think through my files of who you exactly were arguing with 13 years ago.
Yes.
I think I can guess. Yeah. And that person might not be available to respond to our video. So there's sense in not naming names if I'm correct in what I think. So,
yeah.
All right. So let's continue on with, let's dive into the exegesis. And I noticed on here, you mentioned Sirach 3110. I think you and I are in agreement that Sirach 3110 isn't inspired.
Yes.
Although I don't know if there's other reasons you mentioned it here specifically. Maybe just as a general background point.
Okay. So So Sirach 3110 says, you know, who has been tested by wealth and found perfect. So the idea is that the people that are wealthy have specific temptations that maybe other people don't experience. And, you know, some people give into those temptations, some people don't. But so it is a test of whether you're going to be obedient in areas of where you have the wealth and the temptations that arise there. So it's a test that people with wealth go through. For them, it will be a reason to boast. So if they pass the test, then they're morally praiseworthy. Who had the power to sin and didn't, and could do evil but didn't. And so this isn't exactly APs, alternative possibilities. Well, actually, I mean, I guess it is alternative possibilities, but it's not exactly like ought implies can or that sort of thing. It's not necessarily saying that alternative possibilities are necessary for any and all moral responsibility, but it does seem to be saying that alternative possibilities make the person more praiseworthy when they have a chance to sin and then they don't use that opportunity to sin. And when they have the ability to sin in the specific ways that wealth enables them to sin, and then they don't. So they're more praiseworthy. So there is some, it does seem like the Hebrew view does suggest some connection between moral responsibility and alternative possibilities. So, but that's not actually what I'm arguing based on either, because that's connecting it back to moral responsibility. And as I agreed from the get-go, I'm not going to argue based on moral intuitions, at least in this specific episode, but rather just on the plain exegesis of Scripture that we need to hold to the freedom of the will. So, so with that said, I'm going to just let that one sit as it is. It's unless you have something more you want to say on Sirach 31, and move on to other passages of Scripture, which I think are more focused not on the issue of moral responsibility or praiseworthiness, but rather on free will itself.
I'm okay with just at this point, just moving on to the Scripture, since hopefully that's where we'll spend a good chunk of time today. So,
oh, okay. Very good. Very good. So let's start with Ezra 7. And so, okay. So for starters, the Scripture repeatedly uses the term free will offerings, as you well know. And there's at least one usage where the term for free will offering is used in a slightly different context, and that's Ezra 7:13. So this is King Artaxerxes, and he says, "I'll make a decree that all the people of Israel and of his priests and Levites in my realm, which are minded of their own free will to go to Jerusalem, go with you or with thee." So the idea here is it's, you know, after the captivity, and now the Persians have taken over, and Artaxerxes is going to let the Israelites go back, and they're going to return, and anyone that wants to, of their own free will, go back to Jerusalem. And it's the same term that's used for free will offerings. And then if you look up that term for free will, it's got an at symbol in it, so I'm not sure. Nadab, I guess. Nabab. Anyways, I won't even, I could be mispronouncing that badly, so never mind the pronunciation, but the definition to volunteer, to offer freely, to volunteer to give freely, free will offering, free will offered, you know, that's the type of usage that it has. Let's see. I think there was some other definitions and resources. This might not be the best entry, but I guess it works. I'll see if I can find a different lexicon. But I think the issue is the usage is pretty straightforward. It is the word basically translated free will, and it's associated with free will offerings, but it's not about an offering in this case. And I think that actually the same word is used several times in this chapter, and most of the times it's just translated as free will offerings. Maybe the Blue Letter Bible will help us a little bit more.
So Nadav is related to Nadava, which is the usual word. I mean, you can hear the audio similarity between the two.
Right.
But yeah. So like the one that's usually used is Hebrew, is the Strong's entry 5068, and the one that's here, I think, is 5069. But anyway, yeah.
Right. And so in the chapter, it's used again in verse 15. and to carry
And
the
16.
let's look at 15 and 16. You're right. And to carry the silver and gold which the king and his counselors have freely offered unto the God of Israel, whose habitation is in Jerusalem. And some translations just have free will offerings. And then 16, and all the silver and gold that thou can carry in all the province of Babylon, which the free will offerings of the people and the priest offered willingly to the house of God, which is in Jerusalem. Okay, so now I'm just going to place this in contrast here. This is from the Reformed view of free will, but it's just a comment on Fisher and Ravisa's view. Before moving on to exposition of Fisher and Ravisa's theory, it would be helpful to better situate it. Fisher and Ravisa are semi-compatibilists. They believe in causal determinism is not compatible with free will, but with moral responsibility. Okay. Even if it is that they are skeptical of free will, or they just sidestep free will, there's at least a superficial clash here. And we could say, well, maybe they mean something different by free will, but then that gets into exactly what compatibilism is doing, is defining free will. They're accepting some definitions of free will, but rejecting others. And so my simple point here is that just to be faithful to scripture, we need to accept some definition of free will. Now, we might disagree on what that definition is, but some definition of free will, I think, is just necessary to be faithful with scripture. So that's my first argument. So I'd love to hear your thoughts.
My main thought is this doesn't have anything to do with our discussion, because this is something that fits within the first example that Frankfurt gave that we talked about last time, which is the coercion example. This is the example of non-coercion. What's meant here by free is just not coerced. But as we discussed in that previous episode, the absence or presence of coercion is totally irrelevant to the kind of freedom that we're discussing when we talk about the Frankfurt examples. So this
sorry,
principle.
I'm still not sure about that.
Sorry, my watch is not sure, but the point is, the kind of freedom that's being mentioned here, specifically the kind of freedom that's mentioned here, is a legal freedom. There's no law requiring people to go back. So I can, where was it? The first instance was verse 13. So it says, which are minded of their own free will to go to Jerusalem. The point there is, although this is a decree, it's not a decree you people have to go. It's left up to the person. So it's a non-coercive decree. In other words, it's not illegal for you to stay, but if you want to go, then all those who want to go can go. That it's legal for them to go. It's not required for them to go. So it's talking about a legal coercive, the power of the sword of the state is not being applied here. And of course, as we discussed, I think in the Frankfurt examples, I mean, suppose that the king had announced that it is a law to do X, Y, and Z. Well, we saw from Daniel that people can disregard even death threats and do and follow God. So that's not the fact that there's coercion involved doesn't mean the kind of absence of freedom that's relevant to the examples we're talking about. Unless, of course, someone will say that it is, but then, you know, then you're just granting the Frankfurt case already at that first example.
So, okay, so I have two responses, but the first one is just simply, I think you're just starting to get into the definition of free will and finding a definition of free will that's compatible with determinism.
Nope.
So you're not defining free will? You're not saying free will is free in a legal sense? Coercion.
I'm saying that the underlying Hebrew word that's being translated as free will here in verse 13 is just talking about freedom from legal coercion, which isn't the kind of freedom that's relevant to the Frankfurt discussion, according to our last discussion.
Yeah. So are you saying that that's the definition of the term?
I'm not saying it's the definition of the term. I'm saying that in this particular verse, what's being talked about is an absence of legal coercion.
I guess I just, maybe we have to agree to disagree, but I think it's very clear that you're defining the term.
Okay. Well, I mean, we're doing an exegesis and we're trying to explain what the text means.
Exactly.
It's not it's not the definition of the term. It's the usage here in this context.
Why do you care? Why don't you just say the scripture is wrong here? Because you're skeptical of free will in general, or you don't accept free will at all.
Okay. Well,
or is it a value to you that you're faithful to this wording in scripture?
So if let's say that this had said, that this text we found had said that they're minded of their own libertarian free will, and that this was a discussion of their philosophical freedom from logical necessity. If that's what this was, then I'd have to make a choice between saying that I think this text is wrong or something else. But in this case, I don't have to make that decision about whether the text is wrong or I'm wrong, because it's irrelevant to the question. And I'm not sure why that's unclear, but I think it's unclear because you're kind of reading into the word free will a philosophical meaning that doesn't seem to be relevant, at least not in this text. And maybe it would be relevant in some other text, but it's certainly not relevant in this text.
Okay, so let's say that free will is univocal between Ezra and this statement of semi-compatibilists. This means that they believe that causal determinism is not compatible with free will. So if free will is univocal, then Ezra 7:13 rules out determinism on just exegetical ground, if free will is univocal.
The next step of that argument, though, if you're going to accept that there's a univocal sense of free will between the paragraph you're highlighting there on the screen, which uses the phrase free will, and Ezra 7:13, which uses a one word, it depends on the translation and so forth, but one or two words, free will, that expression. If you're saying that the two things mean the same thing in both cases, then you are back to the problem of you're in an interesting quandary. And the reason you're in an interesting quandary is because in the case of Ezra 7, it's the contextual meaning has to do with the legal freedom of the people. But if you think that legal freedom qualifies as free will in the sense that's relevant to these Frankfurt examples, then you should be willing to acknowledge that all that would be necessary for Black to do is to have a law that's unknown to Jones. And if there's a law unknown to Jones that forbids it, then it's no longer of Jones's free will in that sense. So, and I think that's a big problem.
Let's follow it up. So do you think Fisher and Revisa mean legal freedom when they use the word free will?
No, I reject the idea that there's one sense between these two passages. One's a philosophical discussion, one's a discussion about laws.
So
I think they're two completely different discussions, and you're just picking on the word similarity between the two.
Right. Yeah. So are you saying that the word free will has two definitions, one in that Fisher and Revisa are using and another that the scripture is using?
I think that the term free has many definitions.
Yeah.
And there's two examples. Like, one of the popular examples is to say, like, the difference between free like beer or free like speech.
Yeah.
Free, when you talk about free beer, you mean you don't have to pay for it. When you talk about free speech, you mean you have a legal right to speak.
Yeah.
But those are two different meanings of the word free. But it's
right.
Not because we're trying to, you know, wedge determinism into, you know,
right,
somebody's, you know, marketing scheme or into the Constitution. That's not the point at all. It's just that the terms, these English words and words in other languages, have lots of meanings depending on the context. Context is king.
Well, I don't know how to make it clearer than that you are defining the term in a way that's compatible with determinism and different than the way that Fisher or Viz are using. I think that's exactly what you're doing. But if you don't have to agree with me, that's okay. We can move on. So there was a second objection that I had to your comments, which is it's not just the word free, and the lexicons make it pretty clear. There's a willingness to it, a voluntariness to it, that sort of thing. So while I agree with you, so let's say, for example, free will offerings, just straight up free will offerings, right? There are other types of offerings between free will offerings, and it doesn't mean that they're not of free will, but they're required by the law. So they're legally required, whereas the free will offerings are not. Okay, so what I think, the way at least I think of it is, yes, a free will offering is free from a legal requirement. So that's a free from, but it's a free to also. It's that because there's no legal requirement, then it's left up to the person's will or their volition, their choosing. And I think that's what's missing from your analysis. I think you have the negative part right, that yeah, there's no legal requirement, but I'm not sure you have the positive part right, that okay, because there's no legal requirement, then it's up to the person's will.
Yeah, no, that's fair. Yeah.
Okay, so okay, I guess that's the crux of the argument. I guess we could look at some other passages.
Well, hold on a second, though. You can't get out of it that easily from my standpoint. I mean, you have to answer the objection as well. I mean, if you're going to make the argument that the word is being defined in a specific way, you can't just justify it on the basis of a philosophy paper 2000, more than 2000 years after Ezra was written. So what makes you believe that that the term free will here in Ezra 7:13 has the same meaning as a paper from the 19, whatever that was, or even 2000s? I'm not sure.
No, I don't think it does.
So you agree with me.
Two different definitions. You were the one that was saying, no, it's not. You're not. You said that you weren't defining the term. And that's where I was pushing back onto you. No, you are defining a term in a way that is compatible with determinism. That's just what you're
defining. I'm defining which term?
Free will.
In a way that, which term am I in which of the two documents am I defining the term?
Especially in Ezra 13, you were providing a definition that is different than the definition that free will Fisher and Revisa were using.
Okay, but you agree that there should be a different definition than the one Fisher and Revisa are using.
Yeah, 100%. But because of that, right? I think that is the issue. You have to, if you're going to be faithful to Scripture, you have to start defining free will. You can't just bypass it. You can't say, I'm not messing with that. You have to define free will.
But I don't have to define the kind of free will that's talked about in the other paper, right? I only have to define this word that's translated as free will here in Ezra 7:13.
I guess. I mean, if you want to understand Fisher and Revisa, you have to look at their context and see what they're up to. Yeah. But I mean, if you want to stay faithful to the Scripture, you have to define free will and accept that people have some type of free will. You just have to accept that if you want to be faithful to Scripture.
The idea is that you have to accept the term free will with some meaning attached to it.
Yes, that's all I'm saying. That's it.
But it might not be a sense that's in any way relevant to what Fisher and Rivera are talking about. Totally irrelevant to them, but it happens to have the same letters.
So what I'm saying, okay, let me step back. What I think that Fisher and Revisa are doing, I think they're sick of the endless wrangling over what's the definition of free will. And they want to bypass it, and they want to be skeptical of it and just say, we're not going there. And what I'm saying is, no, you have to go there. You have to accept some definition of free will. You have to be a classical compatibilist.
Okay, so here's my question for you. If I were to go to, I don't know who's a good non-Calvinist, incompatibilist exegete for Ezra to tell you, but I'm guessing that if I were to, you know, pick whatever non-Calvinist, non-compatibilist exegete of Old Testament I could find, and I put him here, and I grill it, and I put the question to him, and I ask him, when it says free will here, is it talking about the relationship between the person's will and God's decrees, or is it talking about the relationship between this person's will and human decrees? I think, you know, essentially 10 out of 10 are going to have to acknowledge this is talking about the relationship of the will and human decrees, not divine decrees. So if that's the case, it doesn't seem like there's anything particularly, it doesn't seem like you actually have to make a decision. In other words, if whether you're compatibilist or not, you still understand this text the same way, then I don't understand how it could follow that you have to come to the conclusion you come to. Let me see. It's really tiny on my screen, the text. I'm going to make it bigger. All right, go ahead.
Okay, so this is from the Society of Evangelical Arminians. This document was offered primarily by Brian Bassiano, though. I'm sure he got a lot of help. Let's see.
Okay. Is it an exegesis of Ezra, or is it just Ezra being cited in a string site?
It's in the string site. Moreover, okay. It explicitly, okay, so this, but the scriptures very clearly indicate that people have choices and make choices about many things. Moreover, it explicitly speaks of human free will and provides a bunch of texts that are mostly going to speak about free will offerings.
Who would be a good Arminian exegete that you can think of who has a commentary on Ezra? Or it doesn't have to be Arminian, but anyone who's not a compatibilist who has a good...
Okay. That's a good question.
It's okay if there's not one.
Let me think. Maybe Adam Clark might be an interesting one to look at. No, not Bible Bub, Bible Hub. Come on.
Is that the Clark's commentary?
Yeah, I wonder what he says.
And we said Ezra 7?
Yeah.
I'm almost there.
Yeah, and so to be honest, I don't know. But I think I think what the issue is that we simply are going to define voluntariness and the will differently than you are. So it's not the free aspect. We're going to agree with you that the free aspect is free from legal obligation, but the will part is where you and I are going to disagree. I don't think the will can be determined. But
so the commentary that you just mentioned at verse 13, he says, their own free will is the part that's commented on. And then it says, none shall be forced either to go or to stay.
Right.
He who loves his God will avail himself of this favorable opportunity. So there, in other words, my legal coercion point is exactly the same as somebody who doesn't agree with my understanding of the relationship between determinism, God's...
I don't know. I mean, he would probably say that determinism just is force. But
what he actually said lines up exactly with what I said.
Yeah.
In other words, I totally agree with what he said.
Interesting. Okay. So I think the issue is, what is the will? So you and I are going to disagree on just the simple definition of the will, choice, deliberation, all those things. Like that's going to be the battleground. And that, but in separate episodes, I provided my arguments there. So I think So, anyways, I can leave it at that. I guess I would like to bring up other texts that have this ability to do otherwise that I think has to be incorporated. So it's not just the word free will, but also this idea of the ability to do otherwise. If you're open to that, like to move on to other passage, another passage, unless you prefer to stick it out here.
No, I mean, I think we've exhausted the exegetical discussion of Ezra 7:13. What's next?
Okay, so if we let's see, what is it? Matthew 26? No, it's Mark 14. That's probably a good one. Where's the 1 hour? Yeah. Okay, so this is at Gethsemane where Christ says to Peter, okay, so actually let's back it up. So here, and I'm going to switch translations if you don't mind. We can do it NKJV. That's probably fine.
I'm going to pull up something here. Hold on.
This is a famous passage about Gethsemane. And so Jesus is going to Gethsemane. He's going to pray. And he takes Peter, James, and John with him. And he tells them, "So my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. Stay here and watch." And then he's praying to his father. And then he comes back to the apostles after his prayer. And he says, then he came and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, "Simon, are you sleeping? Could you not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." So this is these are rhetorical questions. Are you sleeping? Could you not watch with me 1 hour? The implication is that he could have watched with him 1 hour. Now we could get into, well, what exactly is this ability of Peter's to have watched 1 extra hour? It's obviously talking about his ability to stay awake, and Christ is chiding him for not having stayed awake, not having followed the command to stay awake and watch, at least 1 hour. And so Christ is basically rebuking Peter for not having stayed awake. So I think there has to be some sense in which Peter could have stayed awake 1 hour if we're going to be faithful to this text. Again, we can get into the definition of what that ability is. I don't want to get into that discussion. We've already had that discussion and we could have it again, but there's no need to. My point here is very simple, that there has to be some type of ability to do otherwise. Otherwise, we're not being faithful to Scripture.
I have a question for you.
Sure.
I don't have a copy of the, whatever the original Fisher and I called his co-author Riviera, which I think is wrong in one of my previous comments, but whatever the
Revisa.
Raviza, I guess. I don't have a copy of that paper in front of me. I wonder if you're expressing the position that Fisher and Raviza as examples of this semi-compatibilist position would say that they have no opinion at all about the existence of any kind of human freedom at all, including legal freedom.
That's a good question. Well, of course they no, they argue against free will. They argue against the ability to do otherwise. In fact, that is how they use the Frankfurt example. They use the Frankfurt example to specifically it Frank the Frankfurt example is targeted at the ability to do otherwise. And I think even in your slides, you at one point they even said, you fill in the blank however you want to think of it. There, let me go back to it. Actually, I think you had a good slide on that.
So, all right.
Okay, anyone with a theory concerning what could have done otherwise means may answer the question for himself by describing whatever measures he would regard as sufficient to guarantee that, in the relevant sense, Jones can't do otherwise. So they're specifically targeting any and all senses of could do otherwise and setting them aside and saying those aren't connected with moral responsibility, including compatibilist ones, including the one that Christ has in mind here.
Okay, so I've sent you a in the chat, I sent you a link to a Google book. I don't know if you're able, maybe you want to stop the screen share for a moment while you go there, but if you or it's up to you, I mean, whatever you like. But I'd be curious, I mean, if this is, I have not, as I said, I haven't read the whole work. I have been trying to find the work itself as we're discussing this. But I'm trying to figure out what you know, kind of essentially where you're coming from. So on this, okay, you
So,
have it up on the screen, I see. So it's the one, the page reference that I have in mind here is the one at page 22. In it should be like, yeah, there we go. So if you click on that, you'll be able to see more of the context, or actually, I may have everything you need. And this is like their footnote 32, and that's a footnote to a comment that they make a little bit higher on the page, I believe.
Back
So,
32. Okay. The actual past and fixed natural laws. So this sounds like a
very,
consequence argument. Yeah.
it says, you know, it will be useful to crystallize this basic ideas behind this principle. To combine, an agent has it within his power to do A only if his doing A can be an extension of the actual past, holding the natural laws fixed. And then they have this footnote down to 32, which is down at the bottom of page 22. And it's interesting, they say the word can, and you notice that word can wasn't in the formulation, but that it was in his power. It's not meant to be the free will can, but rather a wider notion of possibility. One such notion is logical possibility. On this interpretation, the principle says that an agent has it within his power, in the free will sense, to do A only if it's logically possible, with his doing A to be an extension. So if I'm reading that correctly, then it seems like the authors are actually trying to distinguish between a broader realm of possibilities and the realm of possibilities defined in this narrow sense, this free will sense, that has a specific philosophical meaning to them.
Yeah, so okay, so when they're okay, so they will definitely say, hey, look, you can kind of on your own dime, when you if you want to, you can go ahead into this topic of free will and hold to it or not hold to it, hold to it in different senses, as long as you're not holding it to in a libertarian sense. So they'll say things like that all day long, right? And so but that answer, I mean, I've kind of already laid out. If you're doing that, if somebody actually follows through and does that, then they are not semi-compatibilists anymore. They are compatibilists. They're just not. They're not semi anymore. And they will also, like in this case, address the issues of those who do, the arguments of those who do hold to free will. So of course, yeah, they'll get into that level because they're deconstructing their analysis, but that's not in building their own positive case, which is their positive presentation is just going to bypass free will itself and get straight into what is the basic principles behind morality. So I hope that's helpful to you. Yeah, so, but in any case, look, here's the main point. Do you agree with me that some sense of an ability to do otherwise is necessary to correctly interpret the scriptures? Some definition of an ability to do otherwise.
Of course, yes.
There we go. That is the entire point of the video. Now, we could wrangle all day in terms of, well, what is, you know, that exact sense, right? Is it conditional? Is it categorical? You know, is it an impossible conditional analysis and all that other stuff? That'd be fun. But it's not my specific point. My specific point is to have an ability to do otherwise, to have choice, to have free will, you know, you need those things not based only on the grounds of moral intuitions, not based only on philosophical speculations, but also you need those things just to be faithful to scripture itself.
So, you know, my pushback on that point is that it's fine to say that as long as you're explaining that, and you don't have to mean by those statements you just made anything to do with philosophy.
So, okay. Yeah. I'm not going to say that because I think it does have to do with philosophy, but...
So do you really think that in Ezra 7:13 it has to do with philosophy?
Okay, so that's a great question. Yes and no. I'm not loading a lot of metaphysical freight into the words choice, deliberation, and free will. But I think on the philosophical side that compatibilists underestimate the implications of determinism. That it is so widespread that it wipes out even the basic meanings of free will and the basic meanings of choice and the basic meanings of the ability to do otherwise.
Right. And I share that feeling, but from the opposite side. In other words, I think that it's just incoherent to talk about an indeterminate choice. But the question isn't sort of like, do we accept each other's positions? But which obviously we don't at this time, but whether or not Ezra was talking about philosophy or some philosophical, he's making a philosophical point.
Yeah, that's not my point. My point is the philosophy of determinism is so bad that it wipes out even what Ezra was talking about.
Well, I mean, I again, from the opposite side, I would say the same thing.
Of course,
but my point isn't that question. But that's not the question that I'm asking. And that's why it's puzzling to me. It seems like you don't want to answer the question that I'm asking, or you're answering it, but you're taking it one step further. I'm just not sure. I just didn't hear the answer, which is, yeah, Ezra's not talking about philosophy there. Therefore, yeah, you just have to interpret what scripture says, even if scripture's not talking about philosophy.
Okay. So So I am avoiding the humongous discussion of, well, let's define choice, deliberation, free will, the ability to do otherwise. Let's lay all those out. Then let's lay out determinism, and let's see if there's a contradiction in there or not. Yeah, that's a different discussion. Happy to have it, but maybe for a separate episode, because my point was far more modest. It's just simply that you've got to accept those terms and define them in a way that is compatible with determinism, and that is classical compatibilism, not semi-compatibilism. That's my point. That's all I'm here to say for today. And if you want to like try to wrestle those other points to the ground, what I need from your side is, well, what are your definitions of those terms? And then I can give my definitions of those terms. And then what's your definition of determinism? What's my definition of determinism? And then we can see if we can square that circle. I'd say superficially, there's certainly a superficial contradiction in compatibilism in that you can and can't do otherwise, right? Because of determinism, you can't do otherwise. Because of free will, you can do otherwise. And they seem to clash. And the only way to get around that is by defining them not univocally, but defining the ability to do otherwise in a way that fits with the fact that undeterminism is necessary and can't be otherwise in some sense.
Right. And exactly the same way. When we talk about various, some sacrifices being free will and others not being free will sacrifices, the indeterminist or incompatibilist has to define things such that, on the one hand, the offering of, let's say, the sin offering or the trespass offering or any of the other non-free will offerings is at the same time the result of the person's libertarian free will, and also it's not a free will offering. And that's because they're not using the word free will in the same sense in both ways. So I think it's kind of a trivial point to say that we use different words in different contexts in different ways. And I don't know if you think that's worth the whole video. And if it is, it is. I mean, it's fine. But I just think it's certainly not unique. It's not a unique disadvantage to discussing philosophy from a compatibilist standpoint versus discussing philosophy from any other standpoint. Every philosophy, no matter which one you pick, is going to have the same problem. You have to define your terms.
You have
to figure out the relationship of those terms you're using to the terms in scripture and compare whether or not they're being used the same way. And they're not being used. It's not, I don't see if there's any reasonable basis for saying that Ezra 7 is a discussion of philosophy. It isn't a discussion of philosophy. It's literally a discussion about law.
Okay, so let me see if I can focus you on the point I'm trying to make. Are you open to being a semi-compatibilist and being skeptical about free will?
I'm open. When you say skeptical about free will, the philosophical free will, the what does free will mean in philosophy? Now, for myself, I'm not. I accept what the Westminster standards have to say about human freedom and creaturely freedom. And that already commits me to a position which I don't think is merely skeptical or merely agnostic about free will. And I outright reject libertarian free will, which, as I've said many times, I think it's incoherent. But So to say that I'm agnostic or skeptical would be misleading. That said, I could still say I would agree with semi-compatibilist arguments on certain points.
Right.
And I would add to that, like, if the scripture is talking about philosophical free will, and therefore we need to understand what that philosophical free will is that scripture is talking about in connection with other things, then I don't think, it's not necessarily essential to salvation to figure this out. If it were, I think it would be a different kind of conversation. We'd never be saying, that we think that this is not a gospel issue. But, at the same time, even if it's not the central issue, it's an important issue in scripture, the nature of God's providence and the relationship of God's providence to history. It's not trivial, even if it's not the core of the gospel. So, if you're asking me, is it okay to just say we are morally responsible and God determines everything that happens and leave it at that and say, I'm just not going to address the question of the nature of man's will. Is it free or not free? I think I'm more okay with that, because especially once someone acknowledges that people are more responsible, I'm much more okay with setting aside the question of, and on top of that, they have a will that's free from logical necessity or not. That's a very nuanced question.
If someone did that, how would they handle, Christ's rhetorical question, couldn't you wash with me 1 hour?
So regardless of what your conclusion is about people's being free from logical necessity.
Hang on a second. You keep saying logical necessity. I've already many times have granted that I'm okay with the idea of logical necessity in a compound sense. So, you like to draw the line there, but we're on the same side, right? Yeah. So that, I don't think that's the point of contention at all,
I'm not trying to mischaracterize your position. I'm just saying that.
So I'm opposed to causal determinism.
Okay, so if what you're saying is, you're if someone if Let me rephrase what I said then to avoid this speaking past each other thing. So in the case of, I think you can answer, what does Mark 14, 37 through 42, or even I guess a little bit earlier through 42, what does this mean? What's the meaning of the text? I think you can answer that without getting into the question about whether a human choice or action is the result of a causal link to a previous state or previous causal state. I think you can answer the meaning of the text without getting into that aspect of philosophy. And if that's the case, then on some level, you can be agnostic about the question.
So because I agree with you that you can exegete the text without getting into that question. However, here's where we disagree. At some point, you also need to answer that other question of, well, you know, what is the connection between influences and choices and that sort of thing. And you have to have an account of that. And you have to have your exegesis of this text, and you need to put them by each other and ask yourself the question, are these things compatible or not?
So, like, in just taking this as an example, the in this case, he says, I'm trying to see where it says, couldn't you stay awake or couldn't you watch for an hour?
Verse 37, Mark 14, 37.
It's kind of interesting. But anyway, it seems that the point that's being made here, the primary point that's being made here, is that if you watch and pray, you can avoid the temptation to fall asleep. That seems to be the point that's being made. The combination of watching and praying can prevent this slumber.
That he should have stayed up for that hour. He should have. Christ told him to stay up, and he should have done it.
Right. So I think that on either account of whether or not the person's prior causal states contribute or don't contribute to this result shouldn't be directly affected by the correct understanding of the text in any direct way. Now, maybe you'd say there's some very indirect way that eventually, once you look at the second and third degree implications, that there is something there. Maybe so, but the main point of it, it's not directly touched by it at all.
So, okay. All right. We're getting into exactly what I said I wouldn't get into, but let's do it. Given the causation in place, given that he's being causally determined to fall asleep, then he could not watch 1 hour. And he can just tell Jesus, no, because I was caused to sleep.
So it doesn't say he was causally determined to sleep. It doesn't address that. But it doesn't say he was or he wasn't.
Let's say Peter believes that, though. Let's say that Peter thinks that causal determinism is true. And he could just say, I can't. I couldn't have stayed up another hour because I was caused to sleep. Sorry, Jesus. Or not even sorry. I was caused to sleep. So the answer to your question, Jesus, is no. I couldn't have watched one extra hour. It seems, that's what I'm saying. It's, you can exegete this passage without getting into philosophy. But if your philosophy is so invasive, it starts to seep in and wipe out the exegesis again. That's the problem.
Well, hold on a second, though. I mean, you say that you just asserted that there's some pervasive some pervasive thing that's going to come in and wipe out the meaning of the text. But I don't, you haven't actually disagreed with the meaning of the text. And I don't see how that creeps in. And if I were to go, let's say, to a well-known Calvinist commentator like John Gill and look at what Gill says about Mark 14, assuming he has a commentary on it, I don't think he's going to find any, you're going to find anything in there about causal determinism.
So
So,
I'm not
I
saying
mean, maybe you
that
will. I could be wrong.
I'm not saying that Gill is aware of the issue. If he was aware of it, he probably wouldn't be a Calvinist anymore. So it's not a matter of, look, everyone thinks they're right. Otherwise they wouldn't believe what they believe, right? So the question is,
That seems
who
to imply
isn't?
there's a causal previous state of knowledge that results in.
So I think no, I mean, well, the way I see it is someone has two disconnected beliefs that they haven't integrated with each other, and they haven't focused on that aspect yet. So I'm
Okay.
not saying that Gill has focused on it, and I mean, it just seems like the two beliefs are just kind of hanging out in his brain, unintegrated, like a
Okay,
little.
so hold on a second now. Pause, rewind. A minute ago, you said it's so pervasive that it overwhelms the exegesis of the text. And then now you're saying they're not integrated at all. They're just kind of two things hanging out
In
separately.
Gill's mind, right? In my mind, of course, I focused on it and, I thought it through.
But which one is it? I mean, is Calvin, if it really isn't necessary to understand this text, and you can just let them sit side by side, great. And then is it only that it only comes into play when you start asking a question that the text doesn't ask? Like, what if Peter thinks that he is determined to do one thing or another thing, which the text doesn't talk about? But what if, and you throw this what if question, then is that, I'm not sure. I'm trying to figure it out. What are you saying?
Let me say it one more time. So yes, you can exegete the text without getting into philosophy,
Okay.
right? The text is very straightforward. It is a chide. Jesus is telling Peter, you could have stayed up one extra hour, and you should have, but you didn't, and therefore you're guilty. That's what Jesus is, that's the simple point that Jesus is making. Now, if someone, for other reasons, not from this text, holds a belief in causal determinism, they should try to integrate their exegesis of this text with their belief in causal determinism. And maybe they haven't done that. And if they haven't done that, then it's two unintegrated beliefs, and they should do that. They should focus on it. They should think about it, and they should stop being Calvinists.
All right. So when it says the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak,
So
that seems to present a conflict between the person's will and the person's ability. Is that might seem to have an impact on some aspects of philosophy.
So this is okay. So this is the idea of fighting sleep, right? So, I mean, I'm sure we've all been there in the situation where you're trying to fight sleep, right? And you want to stay awake, but you feel sleep coming on. You can force it back, but anyway, so yeah, I mean, I think that's what he's talking about. It all within the same person, right? The spirit is Peter's spirit, the flesh is Peter's flesh, and they're duking it out inside of him as to whether to stay awake or not.
It doesn't look like it's wholly unreasonable to see those as two causal influences.
Okay.
I mean, it seems like there's this, the description is of a war. I mean, that's the whole all that.
Okay, excellent. So let's try to integrate that in, right? So then Peter's response should be, no, my flesh doesn't have the capacity to stay awake. I can't. So could you not watch for me 1 hour? No. Because my flesh is too weak. I don't have the strength to stay up 1 hour. I do not, Jesus.
Do you think that on determinism, and especially compatible determinism, that's a valid excuse on compatible determinism?
Whether or not it's a valid excuse for the command, It should be the correct answer to the question.
It would be a correct answer to the question if it's a valid excuse. If it's an invalid excuse, why would it be a correct answer?
So even if Jesus said, yeah, your flesh is too weak, but I'm still going to blame you for it, right? That's a separate question of what is the truth about the answer to the question.
And Peter doesn't you're saying answer that, the question.
Right? If you're saying that the desire to sleep, or the influence of sleep or whatever, is causally determinative because there's not enough strength in his flesh, right? So it literally causes him to sleep. And the answer is he could not stay awake 1 hour.
Right.
And that is the theory of causal determinism. The theory of causal determinism should lead to a no answer to Jesus' question when Jesus is implying yes. That's the problem.
Assuming, well, that would assume that Jesus' question is not in a divided sense, right? Because what you're saying is accurate if you consider it not in a divided sense. In a without dividing out anything on a deterministic model, everything proceeds according to logical necessity. So without considering things in a divided sense. But if Jesus' comment is within a compatibilist framework, and the expected rhetorical answer to his rhetorical question is to be understood within that framework, then it wouldn't be a hypothetical question would be interpreted in a divided sense, not in a composite sense.
Okay, so we can continue, but in the first place, I gotta ask, are you using philosophy to exegete the statement in Mark 14:37?
No, I'm responding to an objection that's based on a mischaracterization of compatibilism that you just presented. And I'm trying to explain why that objection is invalid. It's invalid because it's not characterizing compatibilism correctly.
Aren't you saying that couldn't you not watch 1 hour should be understood in a divided sense, not in a composite sense? Isn't that what you were saying? Okay, what are you saying then? Say what you're saying. I should listen.
I'm saying if you're proposing a question of how can you reconcile this text to compatibilism, then you have to take the compatibilistic explanation as a whole. You can't just assume that the question would be asked in a composite sense, whereas on compatibilism, it wouldn't be asked in a composite sense. It would be asked in a divided sense. So what I'm saying is you don't have to answer that question about compatibilism or incompatibilism from this text of scripture, which isn't talking about that at all.
Wait.
I'm saying, yeah.
So are you saying that there's three senses, like the sense that Jesus used, then there's a divided sense and a composite sense, and those are three separate senses? How can that
no.
be? I don't understand your point.
Okay. All right. So my position was that Mark 14:37, the meaning that's intended here by Jesus to Peter and by Mark to us, by the Holy Spirit to us, that this doesn't touch on the question of the relationship of man's will to God's providence. This is not discussing that issue. None of the statements that are talking about it are expressed in relation to that question. And the only way to get into it would be, the only way to get into that issue is to start to say, well, if I assume such and such view, then this text wouldn't make sense, which is a question which I thought you had posed. I thought you had said, well, maybe this text isn't talking about the relationship of God's providence to man's will, but if you held to compatibilism, this question doesn't make any sense, or at least the answer doesn't make any sense. In other words, the rhetorical answer, I thought you were saying that the rhetorical answer to the question, could you not watch 1 hour, should be, of course I couldn't watch 1 hour. I'm causally determined to watch 1 hour. And therefore, the rhetorical force of Jesus' point would be lost. The answer to that was, first of all, that on compatibilism, a text like this text, or statements like this statements, even among compatibilists, thoroughgoing compatibilists, are usually expressed in a divided sense. In other words, yeah.
So you are saying that it's in a divided sense then?
Well, I'm certainly not saying that it's in a composite sense. I'm saying it has nothing to do, the question itself doesn't have anything to do with philosophy. And therefore, I guess, I mean, in the sense that I'm not saying some absolute sense. Certainly, like, for example, could you not watch 1 hour? Well, if God has providence that has decreed that it will be, that Peter will fall asleep, doesn't Jesus know that God has providence that governs everything? I mean, Jesus is constantly prophesying about the future as though it's certain and fixed, and there's only one future. So how can he say, could you not watch 1 hour? He knows very well that this has been God's plan all along, that Peter's not going to watch 1 hour. And taking that into consideration, how can that be possible together with this? And you create this composite, right, of God's plan and what actually happened. And you say they have to line up. So the rhetorical answer has to be no. Well, of course, that's not what Jesus is talking about. He's not saying, given God's plan, couldn't you watch 1 hour? No, he's not saying that. Yeah.
Actually, I'll push back on that too. So if Peter believes in theistic determinism and this event is in the past, then he believes this event was determined, right? His sleeping was determined because it's in the
right.
past.
Yes.
And only
yes.
the things that God determines happens, right?
Right.
So,
yep.
so Peter shouldn't, if Peter is a theistic determinist, then
right.
he should already know that.
Yep.
Okay. I mean, so then again, he should have said no. anyway,
but you're again interpreting the question from a you're assuming that if Peter and Jesus are determinists in this question, and they're both coming from that standpoint, that Jesus would be asking him a question that's not in a divided sense, that he'd be asking him a philosophical question about his freedom, as opposed to asking a question like, why are you so tired? Or a question like, why don't you care about staying up with me? Or some other question. Like, there's lots of ways to interpret this kind of statement. And we do talk about it this way pragmatically. This is part of, linguistic pragmatics. The point is that he's pointing to Simon here is, you're not, why isn't this matter more to you? Why are you not doing this?
So,
and that's fully explainable on causal determinism as a conviction of Peter's sinful character.
So I would guess that if you grab your average Christian, even your average Calvinist, and say, give me an explanation of a compound versus a divided sense, they're gonna look at you funny.
Of course.
I think that is a very sophisticated philosophical explanation with fine-tuned distinctions, and
absolutely,
it's highly nuanced.
And it should be, because we're asking a philosophical, highly nuanced question. We're not asking the question of what does the text say?
But what does
the text say is pretty straightforward and doesn't involve it going into this philosophy, as we kind of already established.
Okay, fair enough. I'd like to pursue the matter further, but I think we probably should maybe split that out into a separate video at some point. I'd love to...
What would that question be? I'm not trying to debate that question now, but I am curious how we would set it up for the future discussion.
Is it okay? So I think that I agree that there's a compound and divided sense difference, but I think that I define it differently. Hang on just a second. Let me dig something up. Just give me 1 minute.
Do you want to pause the recording while you do it, or?
Let me see if I can find it real quick.
Okay.
Okay, here. So I did a series of posts on compound and divided sense many, many moons ago, but I'll tell you what, I will send you the link to Arminius's discussion on the compound and divided sense. It's from the works of Arminius, but it's in his discussion with Gomorrah. It's in volume 3. It's not online, because it's in the extra material that's only in the book, but I typed it out. Hopefully I typed it correctly. And maybe next time we can discuss what Arminius had to say on the compound versus divided sense. Now, at the same time, I actually did a bunch of posts on it. Craig on the compound versus divided sense, Suarez on it, Lombard, Bonaventure, Molina. Okay, in any case, I mean, several of them will be different, but I think all these folks are defining it differently than Turretin. So here's what I propose for a future episode, is we look at the way Arminius is setting up the compound and divided sense. Then we look at the way Turretin is setting up the compound and divided sense. And we compare, and we say, okay, well, here's how they're different. You know, here's where they agree with each other, here's where they disagree with each other. I think we'll find that potentially fruitful in moving forward on a compound and divided sense. I'll start with just sending you the link on Arminius, because I think his explanation of it is excellent.
Is this the same book, this where I had at some point transcribed out the part from Gomorrah's to my blog?
The 31, yeah, Gomorrah had 31 principles or something like that, and Arminius responded to those. And you left all of Arminius's comments out, and you just posted Gomorrah's. I remember.
Yes.
That. Yeah, that's
it. I think you had a comment at the time about something like removing all of that wheat, or saving all the chaff from the wheat or something like that.
That's right. Yeah, that's
like,
right.
Like the reverse winnowing process.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, I mean, I definitely find Gomorrah's to be the gold in that particular dialogue, but that's not the point we would want to discuss, yeah. I don't think, for this next one. I do wonder if I think I may have borrowed that book from you. The physical book, I mean.
I think so. Anyways,
I hope that I've returned it to you.
Yeah, we're good. We're good. But I'll just send you a link to this specific aspect, and you can look at the others too. I mean, they're good. But and then look at Turton's explanations of free will, and it should become pretty clear. Okay, this is how Arminius is using it. This is how Turton is using it, and then we could start wrangling the compound versus divided sense to the ground. It would take a lot of setting it up, but I think it could be fruitful just to see, well, here's where Arminius went left and Turton went right or wrong. Anyways.
I think you had it correct the first time.
Okay. Okay, cool. I'm going to leave it at that. I think it's been good. I mean, we did get into... We went further than I thought we would go, but it's been useful, and I'm glad you pushed back on me. I'm going to just say in general, I'm glad you pushed back on me, because I think it makes me focus on things that I should, in my own mind, be integrating together that might be floating around separately. So I'd like to have my thoughts organized, and I think you challenged me to do that in some very helpful ways. So I'm very appreciative of you. And the pushback that you give me.
I'm likewise appreciative. I think there's a real possibility for these kinds of podcasts that we're doing. I don't know if this is like a video cast or whatever the right term. There's a real tendency for some of these to spin out in a direction of what's often called an echo chamber, where, essentially, if let's say that you and I, instead of having these conversations in Calvinism, just had conversations in on some point that where you and I agree, and we focused on those points of agreement, and we criticized other people, it could still be in some ways it could still have the same intellectual fun of analyzing some arguments, but we might fall into the trap of, without even meaning to, starting to caricature the other side's position, and then with nobody there from the other side to push back and say, hey, hold on a second, that's not quite what we said. And I think it would be a real tendency for us to kind of spin out of control. I could kind of see us doing that maybe with like open theists or something like that, because you're not an open theist, I'm not an open theist. We may have slightly different criticisms of them, but I could easily see us quickly, if it was just the two of us, quickly just kind of just, I mean, we could rip and snort over the problems of open theism, but without, if it was just the two of us, eventually we kind of develop our we have risk of developing our own kind of inside joke type of thing that can just, and so assured of our own correctness with no one there to correct, kind of push back. So I really value these interactions, and I value the kind of holding my feet to the fire type of thing that you try to do with these interactions, where, like if I'll say, I say X, and you don't feel like you have to say, oh, okay, great. And you see that even on some of the interview podcasts, because people don't want to irritate their guests, that they kind of just don't push back, because I mean, you want to be a good host, and you don't want to be offensive to them, and then you don't get e either. What happens is there's never any pushback, or the pushback only comes later on another episode when the guest isn't there, and that's not really ideal, I don't think. So I really do appreciate this these exchanges. So.
Likewise, brother. And I think the main thing also is that you can do these in love. And and that's really important, because oftentimes, especially, I mean, these can just devolve into shouting matches and that sort of thing. And so I think it's good that we hold each other's feet to the fire, but it's also good that we do it as brothers. So,
Amen to that.
all right. God be with you.
And also with you.